Dear colleagues, good morning. Very happy to welcome all of you who got up early this November morning and joined us for this 10 a.m. roundtable. Let me introduce myself, Artem Kalikov, the General Manager of Web3 Tech. And I'm very happy to announce open this roundtable, first roundtable for the day, dedicated to blockchain in business and state. And the vector of our discussion is going to touch on using blockchain for government services, but also transborder payments and digital ruble, because certainly these subjects have been intensively discussed over the last days, including today. And today we're going to go to the technology. I'm very happy to introduce our distinguished speakers. We have a great lineup. The brightest in Russian blockchain, very respected and distinguished experts: Andrei Komarov, Rostec Corporation Digital Transformation Director; Yuri Konstantinovich Satirov, Director for Elective Processes in Rostelecom; Anna Shapovalova, CFA, Platform Head from Sberbank; Alexander Nem, General Manager of Sber Blockchain Laboratory; Sergei Harinov, Director for Digital Assets, Moscow Stock Exchange; and Jennifer Trilevich, the General Manager of TPO Consult. Now, let's begin our roundtable with a very short review of the technology market in blockchain, Russian blockchain tech market, to provide a basis for this discussion to see the latest trends in the Russian market. Now, according to Institute of Strategic Research of the Higher School of Economics, the blockchain tech market by 2030 is going to grow to around ₸1 trillion. This means that by 2030 it's going to grow 60-fold and grow to about ₸1 trillion. Now, I think it's overestimated. I think today it's worth about ₸8 billion to this year. However, 70% of the market approximately is represented by DFA and fintech projects, around ₸5 billion. And these are projects of blockchain development, developing the platforms, developing the cryptographic library services, various tools which assist the implementation. Around ₸800 million from the state sector, and about ₸1.5 billion, and other projects, including NFT, including various documentation turnover, supply chains, various pilots, represent around ₹500 million also. And we need to note that the market significantly grows. According to our estimation from 21, it amounted to ₸1.7 billion, and the years 19-20 didn't even reach ₹500 million. However, today we see that fintech today is the main driver. Also, we should note it's not only DFA, but DFA on the most. Now, this assessment correlates to the international trends. Around 74% of blockchain cases and projects worldwide are also related to fintech. Now, what does blockchain contain except for fintech? Certainly, this is classic supply chain management. Certainly, there are successful cases worldwide that are developing. There was a number of serious approaches, but not all of them were successful. A number were closed, such as IBM TradeLens, Marco Polo. They were closed, unfortunately. And we should know the pilots on SED and data notarization, which is important for the government sector, electronic voting, digital voting, digital identification, and various types of decentralized registers for managing organizations and companies. Now, speaking of Russia, Russia today is one of the world leaders on implementation blockchain tech. We enjoy a full spectrum of various cases used at all levels in all the economic centers. Speaking of DFA, this is one of the flagships today. We have 10 operators for digital systems, one exchange operator, and the market for DFA implementation is quite limited. The market of issue and turnover of assets today amounts to around 30 billion rubles, and generally over the next few years it may reach a few hundred billion rubles. However, the tech market for implementation of these platforms at its peak, in my assessment, is not over 2 or 3 billion, and it's not going to go over that in Russia, since it's going to be quite saturated. We also have some cases on digital ruble from CB, certainly. We have digital mortgages from MasterChain and DomRF. We have cash pooling and factoring projects also. Factoring, the most famous project and biggest case, comes from Factorin. Not quite long ago, they recently bought MTS. Now, in governance, the key case is Federal Taxation Service platform, which is realizing various documentation turnover services in terms of loans between banks and the regulator. Also, this is today the biggest corporate government chain in Russia, over 100 nodes, 60 banks, representing over 20 operators for electronic turnover, and worldwide it's quite a unique case, probably one of the world's largest. Now, there are also very important project for the government on distant, on remote electronic voting, remote digital voting, and also IP chain projects in terms of IP rights. It's a very important project that implements the opportunity for monetization of IP rights and IP in, of various authors, like various property such as songs, books, and so on. There is an IP guard project with Roscosmos. It's a joint project which is focused on protecting IP rights. There is Bear project on green certificates, and a Karma project also by the laboratory of blockchain of the Moscow FinTech University. These projects today are the key flagship projects developing in Russian Federation. I apologize if anything was omitted, but this seemed most keynote. Now, moving on. As I mentioned earlier, the first in terms of turnover following fintech is the government sector. One of the most significant players is Rostec Corporation, certainly. It's a, party to an agreement with a government contract on developing blockchain. And Andrei, as the main developer from Rostec, is here. Andrei, could you please tell me of the current status of the roadmap, and how is it developing? Is there enough funds for the projects being allocated? And what is the position of the corporation on this technology? How do they view implementation inside the corporation perimeter and outside? Thank you, dear colleagues. Good afternoon, everyone. Certainly, Rostec Corporation is an active player in this project. Blockchain development in Russia, in my opinion, is one of the most prospective technologies today. And in my viewpoint, there is a problem with this technology. First of all, people don't understand fully how it all works. But once they work it out, they are worried that it's too dangerous and uncontrollable. Sometimes too transparent for a range of issues. It's certainly a complicated challenge in implementation. We have quite a complicated conservative closed organization. However, as Artem mentioned, we have a contract with the government. There is a roadmap on implementation. We selected the most prospective projects. This is electronic documentation turnover, part of the roadmap. Also smart contracts. We propose to realize it, plan to realize, to implement it. There are certain difficulties related to the events that took place last year. Digital security needs have greatly increased, and our data systems were recognized as critical infrastructural assets. So today, looking for a solution on implementation of our current systems into blockchain is a complicated job. However, we're working on that. Now, as for the roadmap and project funding, there are certain difficulties. We saw events unfold, probably you're all aware, in the summer. The ministry, the digital ministry, has stopped the funding of all the digital projects. We hope that the situation will be resolved in the nearest, and these projects are going to be implemented and find their reflection in the priorities of government policy. Now, we are also looking towards development of government services market. In among others, there is an initiative related to governance, actually to management, managing residential housing, so that the owners of apartments using blockchain technologies can vote in terms of body corporate, because today body corporate solutions are a hopscotch, and we need to provide the legislative base to provide additional impetus to the development of this sphere for electronic voting rights for the owners of residential apartments. Now, thank you. Very good. I see, is that documentation turnover inside the corporation you mentioned? Well, we are planning a number of stages in this implementation. First of all, the internal settlements and transactions, and then external, with controlling the whole supply chain, logistics, and so on. So we plan a wide-scale exercise, which, in my opinion, will provide serious effects following implementation. Very good. I see. Certainly, in terms of corporation, with a large number of enterprises settling with each other, many transactions, I think, using technologies, blockchain technologies, is justified. And also, in terms of digital security, Russian crypto providers providing for this turnover can certainly make some headway. Yuri, the digital electronic voting system that is used today is currently the most large scale. In 23, I think over 1.5 million voters used it to vote across 20 Russia's regions. And the technological and worldwide, it's very well developed. Now, could you please tell us how it works, about its properties, and why the blockchain? Hello, dear colleagues. Certainly, I'm the architect of the Federal Platform for Digital Electronic Voting. In Russia today, we have two platforms for remote digital voting. One is in Moscow, and another one is federal. Both platforms were used just recently, 2 months ago on a single voting day. However, because on the one hand we are very close to Moscow and we have many Moscovites here.
Maybe you didn't use the Moscow platform, but this is the territory of the Moscow region. We have crossed the border when we entered the Krokus City Hall. That's why those who live in the Moscow region can recollect the election of the governor, and the federal platform was used at the election. And it happened in 2023. And this year, we had around 1,200,000 people who voted online, and it's less than Moscow platform. Actually, the users of the Moscow platform are the leaders in participation in election, and these platforms develop parallelly. And let's discuss distributed ledgers in this platform. Actually, it exists since 2020, and we have been using the technology of blockchain, or it's also called the program of distributed ledgers. And we get the same question: why do you need blockchain in this platform? And we always answer the same thing. It's quite sad, because yes, we have to use blockchain because it's a database. We use its properties, scaling properties, and unchanging properties, the properties of unchanging data, and it's a blockchain. And we could also say that we use the colon database, or we use distributed storage systems. So they have similar properties. Unfortunately, I might sound pessimistic, but I think that we as a platform, we are implementing the following. Actually, we were supposed to be the beneficiaries of the development of Web3, and we should have promoted the development of blockchain as a decentralized internet, decentralized systems. But unfortunately, it didn't happen. We see that 2023 has almost come to an end. And before my speech, I looked for some information, and I found that there are more than 20 blockchain networks layer one exist. And I think you all know them. You know Bitcoin and Ethereum. There is also Solana, Rana, Ripple, and many other blockchain systems. But unfortunately, not a single AL1 network could be used because it doesn't have Russian origin, and we can't use it on the territory of the Russian Federation. And when they say that we don't use public blockchains, I always say yes, we can't use them, because the discussion on how the remote voting system should look like, this argument has reached the consensus that we have a DeFi concept, we have DAO concept, and we have certain layer one public layer and layer two, which includes those applications which equip you with certain properties. The systems are equipped with these properties like scaling, and they help minimize the defaults of the system, like low productivity. But in the end, the whole activity of the system can be seen in public blockchains. We are forced to do the following. Our system is based on trust, and trust is the major element of blockchain, and we don't have an opportunity to change data. That's why we use a lot of compensating mechanisms. For example, our blockchain, which is distributed between a few sorts, includes our supervisors. They represent the interests of voters, and periodically they make a print of this system, and they record it on the blockchain and place it in a safe. We are forced to do this because we don't have another tool. Unfortunately, we were supposed to get ready-made technologies, and we should have used them in voting system. But in fact, we don't have these systems. We have to offer these technologies. We develop them. And if we talk about remote voting system, we have developed standards such as blind signature, and they were agreed in the technological regulation, so they should reach Russian standard in terms of encryption technologies. And I think we are the only ones in the country who use the proof with the zero confirmation, which is which lies as the base in certain system. We also use holomorphic encryption, and you can also perform mathematical operations with the deciphered data. So currently DEC is supplying the market with various technologies which could be in demand in the blockchain market, and I hope they will be spread and we will fill in this gap and we could reach the level which could be seen in the AI market, because we are at the top level in AI market. And as for blockchain, we haven't reached that level yet, because we don't have Russian stars in this market. We just have fragmented solutions. But talking about a single united network, which would help us to create multiple applications, still doesn't exist. Thank you very much. Thank you, Yuri. I think it's great that such a state project helps to develop encryption science and different logarithms which could be used by business. I think it's an excellent example of developing technologies when they are cut to the project, but actually they are in high demand and actually they could be used in full. And now I'd like to come back to the financial market. And according to Skolkovo FinTech Lab, the bank is among the most investment banks. So I would like to ask Anna, how are you going to use blockchain in the financial sector, in banks? So your bank is one of the leaders of a DFA market, but still you have other interesting cases and pilot projects. Could you please share your experience? What have you already tried and what have you started? Thank you very much. Actually, I didn't know that we are included in certain rating, and I'm happy to hear it. And We have certain experience of work with the blockchain, and you can characterize it with the quotation. So if you haven't tried anything new, you haven't tried anything at all. And I could divide all our projects into categories. We work with Bank of the Service. We integrate different banking services into platform. Yesterday we discussed a lot focus on clients, that clients don't go to banks for loans. Actually, they try to meet a certain demand. For example, they need to pay for a certain delivery, and banks should be present in the place where your client lives and exists. And we have different platforms, different systems. We use AP and also LFAP payment services, which are used to different digital platforms. But before we developed API, we used blockchain, and it helped us to solve our clients' problems. We integrated calculations into different platforms, and we had a successful production case with one big aviation company. And it means that if there was certain trigger, which we get as a bank, and it helps to make payment automatic. So we withdraw money from the account of the client automatically, and we integrated it in our blockchain. And I would like to thank those who helped us do this. And DFA and other products still work on the same principle, complete integration. And the second project, which was also very important, it concerned construction area. It was a digital platform. It automized, it made the actions of all participants automatic. It included contractors, subcontractors, and even raw material suppliers. And also, we were supposed to have certain calculations which were activated by triggers, and you needed to confirm them on the platform and use certain legal documents and compare them with the plan and with the different acts on performed work. When it worked peer-to-peer, it worked quite well, but the idea of the blockchain is to involve other participants in this network. When peer-to-peer interacts with one platform, you can use API. But it's also important to connect other participants. For example, another bank which would also affect payments using triggers. And you should involve other participants who are in different banks, and it's impossible just to unite them in a single unit. And the problem is to connect other participants, and it's not always easy. Not all banks are ready to support you and help your client create a multi-banking system. And this is the first problem which we faced. And the second problem was the digital maturity of platforms which we use. In terms of demands to maturity of the infrastructure and our partners' infrastructure, blockchain demands quite a high level. And before we started using blockchain, we had to resolve a lot of infrastructure problems. And it's important that partner who you integrate, which includes also certain smart contracts, should meet the requirements. He should be reliable, and in terms of signatures and authentication, which we use, we should be sure that everything is reliable, because it influences payments effect, and not everybody is digitally mature. It's what concerns our experience of using blockchain. And the second field where we developed, especially till the last year included consortiums. And we had a few pilot projects, Marco Polo, Contour, and others, and fintech products, banking, warranties, accreditives, payment commitments are those financial tools which are used in the international trade. And it's important to have a lot of participants in this consortium. And we have different cases around the globe. And unfortunately, Marco Polo closed down.
This was a platform that used to join few large German banks around large industrial players. And there was a problem in the rules and the legal framework of these consortiums and the technological layer. In terms of technologies, they came to terms. It was all clear in terms of the blockchain net and the business logic, but on the legal framework level, the consortium couldn't come to terms. The German banks couldn't achieve an agreement over 5 years as to how this platform should work. Pardon the pun, it's similar to how the DFA market works, because it works in terms of technological layer and the legal framework, and they have to be aligned. However, all of the consortiums enjoy the same rules. Legal have to align with the tech used. And we digitalize everything that's in the frameworks. It's important for all the consortium players to be able to come to terms. However, there are successful cases like Contour, for instance, including a number of largest, including Asian super digital banks. And they're backed with a large client pool, and the platform digitalizes the issue and the LC confirmation. Now, they were able to agree on rules and technological development frameworks. So there is both positive and negative experience. Very good, thank you. That was very interesting. Very interesting approach in terms of tech development, blockchain development outside the DFA framework. It's a big field that should be viewed from multiple vectors. And I agree on terms of consortiums and terms of customer service. And the next issue I'd like to touch on is the hybrid approach. Alexander, I know that's better. Is one of the brightest cases of and one of the strongest advocates of hybrid approach, where the properties of private closed blockchain and open blockchain have to be linked to provide maximum output for the users and the bank clients. Now, could you please tell us of your experience? And how are we ready for DeFi, decentralized banking and financial services in terms of hybrid approach? Hello, dear colleagues. Well, I'd like to begin with saying that certainly many experts today feel that corporate blockchain hasn't fully justified the expectations. Those cases that were put forward back in 2015-16 unfortunately didn't make it. Our term mentioned today, well describing various user cases, large projects shut down, trade lands, Marco Polo, we trade among others, the Australian Stock Exchange back in 2015 announced the shift to a new clearing blockchain system. They also shut down this project. They wrote off $250 million. Now, it's important to note an important point. All of this happened back in 2022. When the situation economically, there was global economic downturn, all the companies were cost cutting, shutting down the losing projects. The reason why corporations are slowly advancing in terms of corporate blockchain has a number of reasons. First of all, any corporation is focused on making money, generating revenues. And speaking of blockchain, we need three preconditions, three magic stones. Apart from tech, this is the legal linkage and business cases. If we have all the three magic stones, you will most likely be able to launch a successful product, in case you have resources, of course. But many companies began experimenting with blockchain without having an understanding of the technology, without business cases, and without a legal framework aligned. And when the crisis hit, we all saw those swimming naked, so to speak, and they all shut down. This doesn't mean that we need to forget about corporate blockchain, because today we see a new trend emerging. First of all is tokenization, already mentioned today. Tokenization unites the interests of corporations and investors. Now, at Sberbank, we are closely studying the open networks and closed corporate networks. We developed our own platform, launched the DFA platform, and we thought that could be enough. But no, I'll tell you why we're now building our own DeFi system. It's because we see customer behavior changing. Clients today, especially the new digitally literate generation, are not greatly concerned about how their payments are processed. They are not interested in the back-end part. And those of us that have been in business for a while now, we're used to the fact that all payments and settlements, they have to go across the banking channels. That's the way we were taught. And that's how we work in the industry. It seems it will stay forever, but there are alternative methods. Many today, especially including in a climate of restrictions, are able to use the cryptocurrencies, jump through hurdles to transfer money overseas for transborder payments. And we follow international trends. We see that the hybrid networks are the future. Nobody is divided into corporate and public, but everyone is playing the multi-blockchain game. You have to be everywhere at once, because the clients need many different products. They want to be able to choose, to have the choice, to manage the products themselves, not to depend on a bank in some cases. In other cases, they like to visit the bank. So the world of the future is going to be multilateral. Now, however, the convenience, it always hinges on security. And that's why the role of Sberbank and other regulated institutions is to protect its clients and to provide them safe access into the new digital world. This is our vision, and we're actively testing today. We are admitting, we are using external developers into our work and are launching various DeFi products. Great, thank you. Very interesting to see the development of these products, how this will work out and how this will develop. Certainly, I hope the outcomes are going to be positive, because this will provide a significant impetus to development of DeFi, decentralized financing in Russia. But speaking of DeFi development, certainly the issue of cryptocurrency exchange also rises. I have a question to Sergey. Will Moscow Stock Exchange will become the first and only cryptocurrency exchange in the world? How can stock exchanges play a part in this market? The organization is among critical financial infrastructure, and in its operations, in our operations, we are fully guided by the legislation of the Russian Federation. Certainly, it won't be a secret if I tell you about the prospects of using digital currencies. common recently. So if this will be provided through the standing legislation, well, certainly we are going to provide these tools, add them into our perimeter of business interest. Certainly, it's worth noting we are conducting certain research to even today, but today we won't be able to cross any lines without changes in legislation. Now, basically, I'd like to also speak of the blockchain implementation and agree with previous speakers. Blockchain research has long been on the agenda, and as a representative of the infrastructural community, representative of Moscow Exchange, I can tell you we've had a number of pilots, but you have to understand that business units driving certain initiatives in organizations, they use the premise with dozens of legacy systems, and they need to shift into the modern solution. And now a need rises to quickly shift into blockchain. So you cannot go from legacy, you cannot jump from legacy into blockchain solutions. Blockchain is something else. Infrastructurally, we understand that we have centralized storage. It's quite expensive. Speaking of a certain need, certain level of protection and data security. But when we're told we need to also build nodes and blockchain nets, and they have to be a part of the security and protection chain, and also full support net framework, we understand that the infrastructural costs are going to rise in multiples. There is also the funding issue. Where are we going to find the money to basically provide for all of these projects? We need to find sponsors to provide buyback. Now, this is how we understand today that the representatives of business are not always willing to move further than the pilot cases. It's very good when organizations have innovative development strategies. The use of blockchain is marked as a strategic initiative. It greatly helps, certainly. Staffing issues, however, are also significant. It is very difficult to find experts that are not that are in Russia, not in Dubai, Cyprus, or Portugal. We have a certain shortage of these experts in Russia. I think many of you are aware of this problem. Now, in terms of legal framework, I'm not going to delve into these details. Certainly, we need the sandbox, we need the APRs to pilot all the cases related to implementation of blockchain tech. Let me go into the cases we implemented. We first trialed them in 17-18, some blockchain bonds. So we basically replaced the depository accounting function using the corporate blockchain. First Hyperledger in version 1.1 to do that was launched. Then certainly, you know where this went, it was transformed into DFA. And the second story was the three-party repo using blockchain. We looked at the problem related to removing the middleman. The project was successfully implemented. However, today, however, we didn't find the commercial cases for implementation. Also, there was electronic voting blockchain, so implementation of voting, remote voting on corporate solutions, 80 operations per second, open source code on GitHub is available. If you're interested, I'll share the link.
So you just need to find a real customer who is going to use this. And of course, I will finish my speech at this, because actually we have a lot of promising projects, and we have different points of using clearing operations, using smart contracts, and using technologies for accounting and distributed storage of information within blockchain. But I think we will not have enough time for me to name all these tools. Thank you very much. We definitely have certain we have very certain time limit, and we have a lot of speakers with interesting speeches, and we are happy to listen to you. So now I would like to give the floor to Jennifer. So you're among the first to start blockchain projects, and you created projects, and now you are currently working on the international market. Could you please tell us what is happening in the international market of blockchain, and what technologies are used in foreign projects? What is relevant? We are a Russian company, and though I have an accent, but I work in Russia, we started working in Africa for historical reasons. Actually, we have different blockchain projects in different countries, and they use various technologies, but I would focus on Africa, because I could see that they have certain direction of development, and I think this experience would be very good for Russia. The most interesting field of development for us is mining industry. It was our first project, and we started fulfilling it using our blockchain, and the company who produces jewelry from jewels and from gems. It works with miners, and these miners mine gems, and that country has certain problem that the industry is controlled not by business and neither by the government. Actually, it's controlled by criminals. And these criminals are not only local people with guns who rob them and who exert pressure on miners. We should understand where these criminals originate. There are a lot of African countries where gems are exported to Switzerland, and they bypass the government. Actually, they don't pay tax, they don't pay any customs clearance. And here we talk about serious big corporations in the West who control this market, and it's true. That's why they have a lot of money, and it motivates people not only to do something illegally at the local level, but also to change the transactions so that the government doesn't get anything, and it doesn't let miners work honestly and develop their business. And our partner and we started a project to sell gems from mines to the jewelers workshop. And we had interesting experience. Those gems are not sent by DHS. Actually, they use different couriers to send gems. And actually, they transport it hand by hand. And it's quite difficult to control this process. And that's why we use mobile application, which for lose them, thus they can scan this information from mobile phone to the mobile phone, and blockchain records all this. And there are big corporations who are interested in illegality of this business. And we work with the Ministry of Mining Industry. And it's a quite a complex and long-term process of working with this ministry, because it takes a lot of efforts to introduce this control system at the governmental level so that the government could get taxes and could help contribute to social development of this region. And another issue is controlling the cargoes, because there are some wastes which are not safe. As you know, when oil products are refined and processed, they generate the hazardous wastes. And there are hygienic means which are used to process these wastes. And there are direct wastes which are dumped directly to the soil, and if we talk about oil, for example. And despite the fact that there are certain contracts for these waste processing by companies dealing with wastes, we know very well, it happens in Russia as well, that these wastes are dumped to the landfill. We know where they go. Yes, they sign contracts with such waste processing companies, but actually they dump these waste to landfills. And I see that actually there is an opportunity for development here in Russia. But here there are also some complexities, because we have big money. A lot of big businesses are interested in making these projects die. And there is another project. I'm sorry, but there is not a specific slide on the screen, which I wanted to show. We had some project which concerned fintech. And in African countries, micro lending is actually one of the major types of lending. And it's really difficult to create a credit rating in such countries. That's why they issued a platform when the legislation changed in the country. The project was closed down, but actually it was an interesting project. They used different credit ratings, and microcredit organizations could download information to blockchain, could record it, and thus you could follow where this money come from, and nobody could change that information. And everything was quite transparent. Everything could be seen where money come from. And if there are some loan, some wrong information, you could follow the line and the chain, and you could see where this wrong information comes from. And I used to live in the USA. Such rating is done by centralized companies, and they have serious problems with the change of data, that those data contain mistakes, and they don't follow it, and it's difficult to correct such mistakes. But we were able to start such an honest system in Africa. I hope we'll have such a project in the future as well. Thank you very much. Now we'd like to ask other questions. It was a very interesting case. I hope we will have a chance to start a similar project in Russia with you or with other market players. I think it would be very useful for Russian customers. But I have a question to all of you. If we just distract from the cases linked to DFA and cryptocurrency, what do you think would be the most interesting case of using blockchain, which could be proposed to Russia? And another question is, why we haven't seen this before? What hampers its start? So let me answer this question. I think government registration of rights would be a very interesting project because it will help to reach a new level of assurance and confidence that the asset which you own definitely belongs to you. I think it can pack the whole community. Here I talk about registry of cars and also talk about property registration, real estate registration. And I think here we could have an interesting story. Here we could develop a certain layer of additional services. As far as I remember, Rolf Riester tried to start to issue such a platform, but something went wrong and they didn't do it. Here I would support the previous speaker because the blockchain which would take into account the rights, the ownership rights and real estate rights would be very good for the development and for tokenization of assets. And it would be great if it exists not only in the Russian market, but actually it would create the ground for cross-border projects. And we could see that currently, if we talk about cross-border tokenized real assets and their turnover and the turnover of such tokenization rights in the exchange market is where we could see some prospects. And I'm sure it would be linked to digital finances, digital assets in different jurisdictions. I liked the case with the identification, decentralized identification. I think soon we will have a serious problem among our customers because there will be a lot of different IDs, but users would be able, would still be worried about the use of their personal data because personal data are those assets which are most important ones. And this is what customers would own and operate. And if we are able to create decentralized identity when clients can use their data themselves, it would be perfect. I would also add something. It might sound quite commonplace, but we haven't seen it. Actually, if we talk about a global cross-border system, I think it would be great to have cross-border payment system. We still have problems with payments when we effect payments in other countries, including African countries. And you can't always use Bitcoin. Actually, we should have some financial global system which would be official. I agree. I think it's one of the key needs for the businesses who have foreign trade operations. And I think we have just 1 minute for the question from the audience. If you want to ask a question from the audience, please, you're welcome. Did you have a certain cases on decentralized identification? Did you try to implement such cases, which you could name as the most interesting one? In Russia, I know that in Russia this issue is being raised. We can't still talk about some big cases. These are mostly pilot cases. A lot of research has been done, but in the West they have a lot of such cases. And HSBC started an experiment with Polygon, with the testing ground. They took Polygon 1 and then they opened an account for their client physicist. And corporations dealing with this because they're afraid that they would lose their clients. Do you have any other questions? Nikolai Nosov, X-Media. Could you please tell us how sanctions influenced the development of Russian technologies in blockchain field? Because you mentioned it, but not distinctly. Could you please specify? Well, I can comment on this. Of course, sanctions have had a negative effect, and actually our company has high interest to this technology.
Now, in terms of transborder settlements, there is no single reliable way that would satisfy all needs. However, objectively, it impacted technological development positively. Any more questions? If we have no more questions from the audience, it will be my pleasure to announce the agenda exhausted and this roundtable closed. Thank you to the speakers and thank you to the guests. Now, good day, dear colleagues, and goodbye.
Спасибо.